January 25th, Cosmic Era 71. ZAF Commando succeeded in stealing four of the five top secret G-weapons that were being developed by the Earth Alliance at Heliopolis. After their capture, ZAF would waste no time analyzing them, extracting their technology, and applying it to their own next-generation mobile suits. The first big advancement that they implemented was the miniaturized beam technology, first tested out on the Saigu Deep Arms and the Baku. This would then be carried over to the Gwaze, sometimes also called the Gates, the first ZAF machine to be fully and completely capable of using beam technology. However, this was not without its drawbacks either. The aging Jin had begun to struggle more and more on the battlefield and was in need of a replacement. While on Earth, this would go relatively smoothly with a variety of units like the aforementioned Baku and the Din, in space this was a completely different story, with only limited production units like the Saigu and the Jin high maneuver types. Under normal circumstances, the Gwaze would have been introduced at the same time as the Lego, and would have also entered mass production at that time. But during its development, it was decided to rework the unit to incorporate the data of the four captured G-weapons. Had ZAF stuck with their original plan, the Gwaze would have rolled out much sooner and would have had a much bigger presence during the final stages of the war. At the same time though, this version of the Gwaze would have missed many of its notable features, such as the head-mounted 76mm Seawiz guns and the many beam weapons that it could now use. Mounted on the waist were two EEQ-7R extensional arresters, a type of rocket anchor with a beam emitter that could either shoot beams or generate a beam spike. In practice though, it would almost exclusively be used as a beam spike due to its short range as a beam gun. That is, if the pilot chose to use them at all. The weapon would prove to be unpopular and also quite difficult to use by anyone but the most experienced pilots. For handheld weaponry then, it would most commonly be equipped with the purpose-built MAM-21G beam rifle developed by Myas Military Industries, who also worked on the shield, the MAMV-03 composite shield, which featured two beam claws. All of this ensured that the Gwaze would go on to become one of the strongest mass production units of the First Bloody Valentine War, rivaled only by Orb's M1 Astray. And thanks to this excellent performance, it would be turned into the Gwaze Experimental Firearms type. As its name indicated, this machine would mostly serve as a testbed for many of the weapons that would later be used by the Freedom and Justice Gundams. It had the MAM-20 Lupus beam rifle, a development of the Gwaze's own beam rifle, and would be carried over to the Freedom and Justice Gundams as is, with the only difference between the two being their color scheme. Another weapon that was carried over as is was the beam saber, the MAM-01 Lakerta, ZAFT's first handheld beam saber. On its hips then, it carried a prototype version of the Freedom's MMI M15 Xiphias rail cannons, which were a development of the Shiva railgun, which was used on the dual Gundam's Assault Shroud. Even though the model numbers were the same for the Gwaze's and the Freedom's railguns, its exterior was refined before being adapted by the Freedom. Most notably, the Gwaze's rail cannons would fold in two, whereas the Freedom's rail cannons would fold in three. The same went for the prototype Fatum 00 subflight unit that it was equipped with instead of its normal backpack. Although this piece of equipment would be even more heavily overhauled before being installed on the Justice. Other than a more streamlined appearance, it also received a pair of M9 Carewoos turrets, and its lack of thrust would be fixed by increasing the amount of thrusters from 3 to 6. However, it wasn't just the weapons that this machine was testing out. It would also be the first ZAF machine equipped with the Phase Shift Armor, the Alliance's special armor system that rendered the machine impervious to conventional weapons. Or at least, as long as the machine had enough juice left to power this very energy-hungry system. And unlike Zaf's later nuclear-powered machines, this unit was still using a normal battery to power everything. This meant that if the phase shift armor was running concurrently with its weapon systems, the machine had an operating time of merely 5 minutes. 10 after a secondary battery was installed into the subflight system. Most likely because of this, officially, none of these experimental Guazas would ever be used in combat, but at least one unit is known to have been used during the Battle of Yakindue, and to overcome the extremely limited operating time of the machine, it was hooked up to an external generator. Zaft's later machines, though, would find less scrupulous ways of using their weapons together with the phase shift armor. To prevent the Earth Alliance from launching another nuclear attack on the plants, they had developed the N-Jammer, short for Neutron Jammer, and these devices did exactly what you'd expect them to do. They prevented any and all nuclear fission from happening. Of course, this was a double-edged sword, because now the plants too could not use nuclear fission. So research immediately began on ways to counteract these N-Jammers. This would result in the very creatively named N-Jammer Canceller, which would go on to become one of the defining features of Zaft's top-of-the-line Gundams. The first unit equipped with this new technology was the purpose-built Dreadnought Gundam. In order to save as much time as possible during its development and construction, it was made almost entirely out of parts either taken directly from the Guaze or parts that were upgraded from the Guaze. The only completely new part was its very un-Zaft-like head, which also housed the N-Jammer Canceller. Because of this, the machine had to be temporarily battery-powered when its head was stolen after an attack by mercenary group Serpent Tail. Officially, it was given the name Dreadnought after the archaic meaning of the word, a fearless person or a dreadnought, as in a fearless person or a brave person who would defend the colonies. However, unofficially, it was apparently joked that the Dreadnought was named thus because it would really require a fearless person, be it a dreadnought or an idiot, to pilot this machine with a nuclear reactor right below his feet. Regardless of the name though, the machine achieved what it was designed to do. Thanks to the N-Jammer Cancellers, the machine had enough power to almost indefinitely power its phase shift armor as well as its weapons, which included the first iteration of the Dragoon system that would also be used on the Providence Gundam and various other machines during the Second Bloody Valentine War. Unlike later Dragoon systems though, the pods of the Dreadnought used wires, which were somewhat reminiscent of the Alliance's gun barrel system. But whereas those were used to control the gun barrels, the wires of the Dragoons here were used to supply energy instead. Because of this, they could still continue operating after the wires were cut, but their time limit was unknown. Presumably, it was rather short, because each Dragoon was armed with 10 beam guns and was protected by phase shift armor. And for defensive purposes, these pods could also form an energy shield all around the Dreadnought. Their only drawback was that they required a pilot with high spatial awareness, something that was rare even amongst coordinators. Other mounted weapons included 4 MMI QUA2 Piku Siwis guns and an XM1 Pristis beam reamer mounted on each hip. While these beam reamers were visually very similar to the Guaze's essential arrestors and were even developed from them, they were significantly more advanced. They had a beam gun with a longer range, and rather than just shooting out, they could be controlled by the Dragoon system to serve as extra remote weapons. The cable this time is said to be only for retrieving the reamers in case of malfunction, but it's also suggested that they served to provide energy for them because they consumed a lot of power when in use. And just as the Guaze's essential arrestors could, they could also be used as beam spikes. For handheld weaponry then, it was outfitted with the MAM22Y beam rifle, an upgraded version of that of the Guace, which would later be further developed into the Providence's MAM221 Eudicium beam rifle. And as a shield, it had the MAMV04 composite armed shield system. Again, an upgraded version of the one used by the Guace, but now with a single beam emitter rather than two, and this would then be further developed for use by the Providence in the form of the MAMV05A composite armed shield system. Normally, the Dreadnought was meant to be dismantled and disposed of after testing, but instead it fell into the hands of Prayer Reverie and, after this, Canard Parse. Because the latter couldn't use the Dragoon system, the Dreadnought would be modified into the Dreadnought Eta by everyone's favorite Junk Guild technician, Lo Gyul. The machine would essentially be the Dreadnought Gundam with a new backpack, the Eta unit, and a few touches from Canard's previous machine, the Hyperion Gundam Unit 1. The Eta pack had a pair of large binders that housed a beam cannon each that could also emit a large beam saber. And in addition to these, it also had two smaller binders housing 40mm Seawiz guns each with a grenade launcher underneath. By repositioning these binders, the Dreadnought could switch between Buster mode and Sword mode. For handheld weaponry then, it retained the Super Hyperion's RFW-99 Zastava Stigmate beam submachine gun, which was connected to its nuclear reactor through an energy cable. For defensive purposes then, it had a pair of Armure Lumière handy monophase lightwave shields mounted onto the hips, which were developed from the shield generators of the Hyperion. Just like the submachine guns, these were hardwired to the machine's nuclear generator, providing them with ample amounts of energy. In order to use them, these generators could either be handheld or mounted on the forearms. And in addition to generating a defensive shield, they could also be used offensively as a beam lance to penetrate other lightwave shields, positron shields, and potentially even beam shields. But back to the Guace now. After their success during the First Bloody Valentine War, they would be further developed and further upgraded into the Guace R. The unit featured better mobility thanks to a repositioning of some of the thrusters from the backpack to the backskirt, and some of its weapons were also changed. The difficult-to-use extensional arresters were replaced by a development of the railgun from the experimental firearms type, and the twin beamfang shield was replaced by the MAMV05 composite shield, which featured only a single blade, a design choice inspired by the shield of the earlier Dreadnought Gundam. Despite being a great improvement over the original Guace and being a more than capable machine at the time of its deployment, most experienced and ace pilots had already moved on to Zaft's next generation machine, the Zaku, never giving the Guace R the chance to shine like its predecessor. Worse yet, it was even shown being outperformed by the older Gen High Maneuver Type 2. And that is unfortunately how the design lineage of the Guace itself ended. Not with a bang, but a whimper. Fortunately, the machines that it laid a foundation for would see much more success. So be sure to leave a like and subscribe, because next time we're having a look at the development history of the Freedom, the Justice, and all the things surrounding them. As always, a big thank you to the Patreon supporters. I hope everyone watching has a great day, and I'll see you all next time.